Welcome back to New Hanover Evangelical Lutheran Church, and we're all here to worship today and celebrate. Today is World Communion Sunday, where we're celebrating with all Christians across the world, and today is marked as a day where, you know, no matter where you're at in this world, in this cosmos, we are called to share communion with one another, with our brothers and sisters.
Amen.
And everyone. So, all good, and that's exciting. So, with that, get your bread and beverage ready. Also, light a candle, bring in the presence of Christ into your house, and if you don't have it already and you want to follow along on the music and have the song sheets in front of you, I ask you to go to newhanoverlutheran.org. You only hear that message about 10 times during the service, but you'll find the songs and find the readings and the whole order of service on there, and you can download it right in your very home. So, without further ado, let's get our worship started.
Okay.
The Holy Spirit calls us together as people of God.
Amen.
Amen. So, Susan and Priscilla, please lead us in My Lord of Light. Thank you. Turn back to your worship bulletins. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Beloved God, from you come all things that are good. Lead us by the inspiration of your Spirit to know those things that are right, and by your merciful guidance help us to do them. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Get those song sheets back out. If you turn to the back of your bulletins you just downloaded, or you find it on your tablet, whatever you're working off, we are going to Christ is Made the Sure Foundation. Thank you. Amen. Certainly is. God speaks to us in Scripture, reading, preaching, and song. Our first reading today is from Isaiah 5, and get your Bibles out or get out your bulletins and follow along with Brett Boyer.
Psalm 80, 17 through 15. Restore us, O God of hosts. Let your face shine upon us, and we shall be saved. You have brought a vine out of Egypt. You have cast out to the nations and planted it. You cleared the ground for it. It took root and filled the land. The mountains were covered by its shadow, and the towering cedar trees by its boughs. You are stretched out to its tendrils, to the sea, and its branches to the river. Why have you broken down its wall so that all who passes by plunk off its grapes? The wild boar of the forest have ravaged it, and the beasts of the field have grazed upon it. Turn now, O God, God of hosts. Look down from heaven, behold, and tend this vine. Preserve what your right has planted. Here ends the reading.
Thank you, Brett. So, yeah, it is time, Richard. Yeah, it's dancing. Hank, you're dancing a little bit. Okay, even Hank's dancing. And so come on down. Get all the kids and come on down and get in front of the screens there, whatever mobile device you have. And we have a very special message coming to you today. And
from who?
Oh, Nevada Grant
from
is
Nevada.
Giving her message. So, okay. Nevada, lead us home.
Good morning or evening or midday. Whenever you're joining us, boys and girls, I am glad that you're here. Today, we're going to talk about those things that just make us feel a little bad, not so good, you know? Because that happens to all of us. Maybe I forget to do my homework. I take that feeling and I bundle it up, and you know what? Instead of throwing it away, I keep it. And that feeling when I get into a fight with my brother or with one of my friends, no one likes to be in a fight. I bundle up that feeling and I keep it. Sometimes I just have a bad day. Nothing quite seems right. And I take that just bad feeling in my stomach and I bundle it up and I keep it. And you know what? All these things pile up. They certainly do. And you hold on to them and it gets heavier and heavier and heavier. And it just feels like so much, super overwhelming and stressful. But what today's gospel lesson reminds us is that we shouldn't be holding on to these things. God forgives us for getting into a fight with our siblings. Get rid of that. God says tomorrow's going to be a better day. Get rid of that. He forgives us for not doing our homework and knows that we'll do better next time. Get rid of that. And all these other mistakes and just bad feelings in here, he says, get rid of all those too. Say bye. And the whole bucket that we keep all of our bad feelings in, say bye to that too. Because none of that's important. What is important is God's love, God's forgiveness, and God's way of renewing us. Whenever things are bad, he makes them good again. And it's incredible how powerful his love is, because his love does all of that for us. His love gets rid of all of our mistakes. So just remember that in this upcoming week. Whenever you have that bad feeling, God is going to make it good again, because God loves you and God is good. Please fold your hands and we're just going to give a quick thanks for all the amazing things God does for us. Dear God, thank you for always loving us. Thank you for always forgiving us. And thank you for always renewing us. Amen. Okay, great. Have an amazing week, boys and girls. And remember, God loves you so much. Bye.
Thank you, Nevada. That was really special. I appreciated it. So Brett's back here again, Brett Boyer. So turn your Bibles or get your bulletins out and follow along in Philippians 3.
The second reading, Philippians 3, 4b through 14. Paul writes, if anyone else has reason to be confident in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, a member of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, and Hebrew born of Hebrews, as to the law of Pharisee, as the seal, a prosecutor of the church, as a righteousness under the law, blameless. Yet whatever gains I had, these I have come to regard as loss because of Christ. More than that, I regard everything as a loss because of surpassing value of knowing Jesus Christ, my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things. I regard them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but one that comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness of God based on faith. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the sharing of his. By coming like his death, if somehow I may attain the resurrection of the dead. Not that I have already obtained this or have already reached the goal, but I press on and make it earn, because Jesus Christ has made me his own. Beloved, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but this one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead. I press on towards the goal for the prize of the heavenly call of God in Jesus Christ. Here ends the reading.
Thank you, Brett. Open up your bulletins, and now it's now follow along with the gospel acclamation. Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now Jesus said to the people, listen to another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard, put a fence around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a watchtower. Then he leased it to tenants and went to another country. When a harvest time had come, he sent his slaves to the tenants to collect his produce. But the tenants seized his slaves and beat one, killed another, and stoned another. Again he said to the other slaves, more than the first, and they treated them in the same way. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, they will respect my son. But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, this is the heir. Come, let us kill him and get his inheritance. So they seized him and threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. And Jesus asked them, now when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do with those tenants? They said to Jesus, he will put those wretches to a miserable death and lease the vineyard to other tenants who will give them the produce at the harvest. Jesus said to them, have you ever never read the scriptures? The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This was the Lord's doing, and it's amazing in our eyes. Therefore, I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people that produces the fruits of the kingdom. The one who falls on a stone will be broken to pieces, and it will crush anyone of whom it falls. When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parable, they realized that he was speaking about them. They wanted to arrest him, but they feared the crowds because they regarded him as a prophet. The gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
So we have this story set up here today, and just happened to fall on Communion Sunday, but not much communion in any of this, but there's a lot of grace. There's a lot of grace, so which is all about communion. But what we have here is sometimes you could say, that's a vineyard. Why is he putting a fence around it? And then why is he putting a watchtower? Who does that? Well, you can talk about and say, well, maybe it's because of he wants to protect everything in there, you know? Maybe there's a lot of animals, or maybe people were coming in there from before and trashing it, and plus he's living in another land, or maybe he should be protecting the other people living outside, right? Maybe he knew the tenants, you know, and
They're
beating up everybody and killing them. Maybe he wants to protect the other people from them, you know? And so, I don't know. It's kind of astounding, but you think of it, it made me think. I was driving in a car with Chris, our new director of food ministry today, and we're going up picking up supplies and talking about the program and food ministry and we want to expand it, you know, and get it even more for bigger. And he served over in Germany in the army, and he brought up Buchenwald, you know, in the one of the concentration camps. And he was saying that if you ever go there outside of Munich, you can witness that the homes and the farms nearby of Buchenwald aren't that far away. I mean, they're it's not like they're miles away. And so what happens is that he was struck by the fact that, you know, even though they must have heard so much screaming or agony or witnessed so much activity of all these people coming in and bodies coming out and bodies and that. But when they were asked after the war, they said, we didn't know. We didn't know what they were doing. And part of you would say, like, I don't think so, you know. And other parts, you think about how in life that you just get so used to something and you don't pay attention to it. Like, I know myself, like, when I got my call from God that it happened in at a youth conference down there in Atlanta. And we were working with these children from Sarajevo. And they were talking to us about the war. And they built up this model underground city that they lived in for 4 years during the 90s. And I'm thinking to myself, I'm like, what? You lived underground for 4 years? And they said, yeah, we were being captured by the Christian armies and Serbian armies and put in sex concentration camps. I'm like, concentration camps? That doesn't happen anymore. And I'm thinking to myself, and I'm thinking, this is ridiculous. This went on during the 90s, and then it struck me and brought me to my knees. And then after I walked through it and got educated about it, and I met the young men and women, they were in their teenage years then, but they were, you know, they were when they were children, and they were telling the stories about how the people were captured and beaten and killed or put in sex concentration camps that they were young. And I thought to myself, no, we said, you know, after World War II, this was never going to happen, never again. And yet, the world let it happen, and it happens today in some regards. And I think, you know, how I was in the 90s, totally oblivious. And if somebody would have asked me before I went to that youth gathering and been exposed to that and educated about it, I would say, no, there hasn't been any, you know, concentration camps. And then that they were happening in the Sudan at that time then too. So they, in the early 2000s, we had concentration camps throughout Africa in some of these countries. And people were being, you know, captured and put into sex concentration camps and work camps and beaten and killed and mass graves. And it makes you wonder, well, what makes the people in Germany, what made us being so oblivious about it? And I guess it teaches you that you never can be too comfortable, you know, in knowing. Meaning that when you're told stuff, you sometimes you just can't take it for granted. And it goes on without saying. And it's like they say, well, you know, a pastor that, you know, the news, and I watch this, I listen to that, But I know from the experience and past experiences that you got to be careful on that. And I think God is reaching out and you know, the truth lies somewhere in that Bible, you know, in the word of the Bible and in here, and about, you know, that God's telling us, you know, this will happen. These things do happen, and this will happen in the world. There is evil in the world. And then, you know, I think of that story about people said, well, you know, you can never boil, you know, a frog by just throwing it into the pot. However, if you put the frog in the pot, this is what I'm told, and I should have checked out the story. I'm just telling you about not believing anything. But you put the broad in the cold water, the frog will stay in there, and then you turn the burner on, and basically it heats up slowly. The frog will just stay in there and get boiled. And I think that's where we find our chief priests in here, you know? The chief priests have, for a long time, they were in cold water in the beginning. They were immersed with the word of God, and they just had this great worship and so forth. And then, but over the years, and Roman occupation took over Israel, and the oppressors were there, Rome, you know, and they were crucifying people and putting them up on the you know, crosses and outside the city right before Passover, when Jesus enters into the town, and people are hanging there dying. And you can imagine the religious leaders said, come on out to the celebration, everything is good. And meanwhile, they're putting people up on crucifixes. And you can imagine these chief priests are like those frogs. And I think God is telling us Jesus came in to shake up the world. And he turned these things over and increased heats. These chief priests, they just fell into being totally unobservant of what was going on around them in the world. And where we say that nevermore, we have to be careful. We have to pray and read the Word of God. And also we have to be able to speak up from those that are being oppressed, for those that are being put in quote-unquote concentration camps or having their freedoms taken away from them. I think it's a time when we stand up and say no more. Everybody has a right in God's eye to live and not to be oppressed. And that's the good news, where Jesus came, and yes, he died, but he died so all of us could live. Amen. I guess one could say the chief priests, they lacked the heart of worship. So maybe on this World Communion Sunday, we can do something for the world. And that, you know, a lot of Christians, like these people that are these servants of God that went and were beaten and so forth, we forget that sometimes, you know, we have it nice here in the United States as Christians, and we have it generally very secure, right? and we don't worry about going to our houses of worship on a Sunday and going places and praying in public, because we don't think we're ever imagine being beaten and killed for our faith like the prophets in this story, or even Jesus Christ. However, I think a lot of our other Christians, our other body of Christ, which is around the world, people are suffering because they believe in Christ, and they're standing up and saying, I believe in Jesus Christ as my Savior and God, and they're publicly professing their faith, and they're being minimalized, and starts sometimes with their land being taken from them, and then some of their rights, and in countries. And when I recently visited Jordan, one of the original Christianity countries in there, and right there at the River Jordan where it meets there, and their population is so small now anymore because they're starting to get their rights taken from them as Christians, and other parts in Egypt and other parts of the world where it's being very minimalized in Africa, and they're being attacked and their houses of worship and killed. And I think maybe today on World Communion Sunday, when we receive the body of Christ and we receive the blood of Christ, we can truly think that it's for you. For you. and how that must feel. We're the only hope of other Christians in the world and places where they're being persecuted is to think of the glory of God and the promise of God of everlasting life, forgiving God's Son for you. So today, it's not a day of works, and I'm not asking you that you have to do it, but maybe the good news is to research. Maybe pick up that phone instead of looking on Facebook a little bit, or checking out people, or putting your picture on Instagram. Maybe check out the martyrs of Christians, the ones that are dying today, just for you. Amen. And maybe that's where we find the chief priests. They were very comfortable in their sanctuary and in the temple. Meanwhile, while the Romans were persecuting and crucifying people outside the city of Jerusalem, it was just, they lacked heart, a heart of worship.
When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come. Longing just to bring something that's of worth, that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship. It's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, for it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. King of endless worth, no one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, all I have is yours, every single breath. Sing you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, and through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, 'cause it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus.
Joined in the one spirit, let us confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Call together as brothers and sisters and all in the name of Christ, we pray. Almighty and graceful God, on this day, we pray for the body of Christ, those that are behind secure walls, as in a parable, and those that are not so secure and are being beaten and even killed for their faith in you, Almighty God. So we reach out today and say a prayer, and may we say it every day, for the total body of Christ. For if one of us hurt, we are all damaged, dear Lord. It's like if our toenail gets damaged, we all feel sad. And so let us just pray for everyone, Almighty God. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty and graceful God, not only is humans being destroyed for the faith in you, but our earth, your creation, is being scorched, and out in the west coast of the United States, dear Lord, and we pray for all those out there that may find relief, and may the weather help them, dear Lord, and may the rains come and help them put out these fires, dear Lord, that are destroying so much. We pray for all those that are grieving and lost, and we pray for those that have lost their homes and still continuing with the flooding down in our Gulf Coast, dear Lord. And we pray for the world. We pray for all those that are being damaged and poor. We ask you to help us clean the oceans, as we've been having some major oil spills, and we are changing your creation, dear, and harming it. And we just ask you to be with us and give us the wisdom and discernment to help heal it. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty and gracious God, we pray today for all those who help and helping hands that make worship help. And today we usually pray, dear Lord, for our altar committees and those who set up a communion. And we also pray for our organist, and we pay for our musicians, dear Lord. But so much more goes into worship anymore, dear Lord, in this virtual reality. So we pray for our videographer. We pay for our sound team. We pay for our ushers and the people setting out cones out in the parking lot and the people wearing vests and parking people safely. We pray for those that help us with the broadcasting, dear Lord, and those who post things on the internet. And, dear Lord, you're making it happen by these special gifts. And so we pray for all. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty and graceful God, we pray for those saints that have gone before us and those saints who die every day for us. We pray, dear Lord, that you be with their families and you help them through these struggling times, dear Lord. We just ask for your blessings upon the John Dodderer family, dear Lord, and help them in their grieving and also help them in their coping, dear Lord. And we just ask you each and every day, just be with us, and may we thank the saints that have gone before us, who have taught us how to pray, how to receive communion, and how to praise your glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
All these things, dear Lord, we pray for, and everything else that we don't say, you know we need. In all your name, in your Son's name, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Well, comes a favorite time when we share peace with one another. So Richard and Hank, peace be with you.
Peace be with you, and also with
Amy
you.
Amy and everybody out there, peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
At this time, we normally take our offering, but however, as you know, we don't do our offering right now. I just want to thank you because you've been so good. We've been getting more and more offerings in, and people are picking up on mailing them in. Also, you can drop them off in our fellowship hall door slot, and there's a container there. You push it through the little mail slot that's just opposite the golf course. And of course, you can go online and sign up at our top at our webpage. newhanoverlutheran.org, and there's a giving section right at the top. You click on that, takes you a few minutes, and you could be done for the rest of your life. You just figure out how much you want, and boom, it'll do it. Or you can just do it one time. We thank you for everything. Thank you very much, and God bless you. Well, we got a great, loving congregation. They just never stop sharing a piece.
I know. It just drug on there forever.
Yeah, and even remotely.
Yeah.
They're peace, peace, peace. Those crazy
Lutherans. I miss the honks, though.
Yeah, the honks. Yeah, and then bring the Holy Siren in there. We'll have to bring that into the Thursday worship now. And we'll be coming back here, so it won't be far away.
Excellent.
Well, that brings us to Holy Communion. Ask you at this time, if you haven't got it already, grab your bread and your beverage, and let's get on with our meal. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
And the night he was betrayed, our Lord took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and he gave thanks and gave it all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The body of Christ, given for you, take and eat. The blood of Christ shed for you, take and drink. We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through the healing power of this gift of life. In your mercy, strengthen us through this gift. And faith towards you, and in fervent Lord towards one another, for the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, we have a lot of announcements this week.
As always.
Woo! But this week especially. So, worship is not going to be in the picnic grove anymore. No, it's going to be back in the parking lot. Drive into the parking lot. Yep. Yep, and all the golfers across the street, they're not going to be too happy. But they love us, so they do.
They do.
So they just act like they don't like us when we're beeping our horns and the Holy Siren comes out during during their backswing, but they just love us. So, so come back for the whole month of October. We're going to be doing drive-in worship in the parking lot. Then, can I have a drum roll? Where's our drummer? We lost our drummer. There we go. November the 1st for All Saints Sunday. We will be back in the sanctuary.
Woo-hoo!
Yeah. So get prepared, and you can find out everything. It's coming out on your newsletter, and you can check it out online on our newsletter on our webpage, newhanoverlutheran.org. That's only the third time I said that so far. And also, we will be posting it on Facebook, and then also you'll get a one-call notice and reminding you that worship on November 1st will be back in our sanctuary. So praise be to God. Upcoming communion services is today and next week on November 1st for All Saints Sunday, and then not again until October 25th. So the next two Sundays we're not going to have communion. Harvest Home will be next week, and so October 11th. So we are going to try to blow out any kind of offering that we have made as far as food, because our food ministry is growing. We're over 102 people a day, and we surpass the 16,000. We're growing on the $17,000 mark. I think we're even actually creeping up on 18,000 meals delivered. So it's a phenomenal thing, and we're getting great recognition, but that more important, we're getting great feedback from the people saying how much they are blessed. So please come out on October 11th and Harvest Home. Bring in your hamburger, your chicken, your fresh vegetables, your frozen vegetables, all those items and snacks, and then as well as non-perishable goods for Boyertown's multipurpose, because that helps out people too. So those same people that we are feeding food and delivering food, they also get some non-perishable items like household goods and self-hygiene products and so forth. So come on out. Let's blow it out on October 11th, Harvest Home. And then last but not least, we're having a Fall Faith Formation Fest, and that's October 25th. And so we're kicking off the season, and so all come out all ages, and there'll be little bags there for you. And so, things for your age-specific group and do different activities. And so you can have Sunday school at home or Sunday school with your family or in the park or wherever you're at, all the way up there in the nether regions of Pennsylvania, Hank. Pick up your book, and you can join us in devotionals while you're still up there in remote land up there and camping, and so we can do it. You could even do it with Taekwondo.
I do jujitsu. That's jujitsu. What we're looking for. I'm a martial arts person too.
Yeah, so you got to get your kit, Richard. And then I did say there is nothing to follow, but I will follow Jesus.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow. Oh, oh, oh. All your ways are good. All your ways are sure. I will trust in you alone. Higher than my sight, high above my life, I will trust in you alone. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Whom you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this if I lose, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Yeah. Light into the world, light into my life. I will live for you alone. You're the one I seek, knowing I will find. All I need in you alone, where you go, I'll go, where you stay, I'll stay, when you move, I'll move, I will follow you, whom you love, I love, how you serve, I'll serve, if this life I lose, I will follow you. In you there's life everlasting. In you there's freedom for my soul. In you there's joy, unending joy. And I will follow. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Whom you I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. And I will follow you. Whom you love, I love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you.
Well, I'll follow you indeed, Jesus. And God blesses us and sends us a mission of the world. Now go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Go get him. So until next week, we'll see you, gang. Take care and harvest home next week. So send in your donations.
May the Lord who comes to seek give you his peace. May he wash over you and me. May his blessings never cease. He is